Hi everybody, Captain Al speaking with your training tips designed to help make you a better, more knowledgeable flight simmer, pilot, or aviation enthusiast. Go ahead and have a seat. Let's strap in and stow the HUD and see what is on the horizon for today. Our briefing today will cover the electronic flight instrument system. We're looking at the PFD, primary flight display, and specifically within the PFD, we're looking at the heading display. There's many types of heading. True course is the course that's plotted between two points, but takes into account no corrections. A magnetic course is true course plus or minus variation. Remember that the true North Pole is different than the magnetic North Pole, and you have to take into account variation. If you remember from basic training, I believe it's east is least and west is best, if I remember correctly. And once you have the variation applied, that will give you your magnetic course. Once you have the magnetic course, then you can modify that by winds. And once you apply winds to that, then you get the magnetic heading, which is what the airplane flies. The ground track is the course that the aircraft is flying across the ground, the actual flight path across the ground. And a great circle course is the shortest distance between two points on the surface of a sphere. Typically, many FMCs will use the great circle course to navigate from waypoint to waypoint. How is heading generated in a jet? Well, it's generated by the inertial reference system. Specifically, you have in the 747, you have three IRUs, inertial reference units, that supply heading. Or in some airplanes, it'll be an ADIRU, an air data inertial reference unit. In the 747-8, there's three of these. In some airplanes, there's two of these. But in most cases, you'll have two or three IRUs or ADIRUs, depending on the airplane. How is heading displayed in a jet? Well, again, steam gauges versus the glass displays. In the olden days, you had the round dial steam gauges. In the more modern days, in the more modern jets, you have the glass display. And the heading portion of it is displayed on the PFD. It's displayed at the bottom of the PFD. And with the heading track indication, we're looking at a expanded compass rose. This is usually about 70 degrees from side to side. The heading is denoted by an upside down triangle. There is a white line that represents track, and then the heading reference can be magnetic or true, and the selected heading is always shown in magenta. So we have a selected heading marker, and we have the selected heading numerical value, as well as the H denoting that it is the selected heading. The magnetic or true indication is green. The upside down triangle is your heading reference. And the track line is denoted by a white line. Again, 70 degrees from side to side on the heading display. Of course, the difference between heading and track would be if you have a headwind or a tailwind that's direct, the track and the heading will be exactly the same. The way the airplane's pointing is the way you'll be flying. So heading and track would be exactly equal. If you have any sort of crosswind, then the way the airplane is pointing will be different than the way it is actually flying. So the heading of the aircraft would be shown in yellow here, but the actual track of the airplane would be shown in green because of the crosswind that in this case is blowing from right to left. And then the difference between the heading and the track will be the drift angle. And some jet aircraft, the display can be heading up, where heading is displayed at the top. And in some jet aircraft, you can have track up displays. You can also have one instrument that shows heading up and another instrument that shows track up. Sometimes this is an option for airlines that they want the ND, for example, to be a track up display, or they want the ND to be a heading up display. In most cases, most airlines want the ND to be a track up display, but the heading display on the PFD will be a heading up display. The difference is just what's displayed within the box. In this case, this would be a heading up display, where the upside down triangle would represent the heading and the track would be referenced by the white line, but heading would be displayed at the top. In this case, track is displayed at the top. The white track line would go from the airplane symbol all the way to the compass rose. It would be at the top of the display, and then heading would be displayed as the upside down triangle. And you can see in this case we have a crosswind blowing from right to left, so the heading would be different than the track in both cases. It's just that in one case the heading is off in this direction, in the other case the track would be off in this direction. So in the case of the PFD, which you see on the right side here, it's a heading up display. The upside down triangle's at the top. The track line is offset if there's a crosswind. And heading is the preferred mode, if you think of it that way, for the PFD. For the ND, that could be shown as either a heading up display or a track up display. Again, airline preference, what they want. Most airlines will choose this to be a track up display. So you'll see track displayed at the top, and then the heading will be represented by the upside down triangle. The heading will automatically change from magnetic to true above 82 north and above 82 south. So if you happen to be flying from a region below that to a region above that latitude, then you'll see the reference change from magnetic to true automatically, as long as your heading reference switch is in the normal position. There are some areas where the heading will change from magnetic to true. Above 73 north or above 60 south. And you can see that denoted in the diagram here. This is, sometimes we refer to this as the keyhole. Between 80 west and 170 west, from 73 north on up, this is where heading will change to true automatically. If you're outside of that latitude range, then it's going to be above 82 north where this changes. In the southern hemisphere, between 120 east and 160 east, if you transit through the 60 south, then this will change from magnetic to true automatically. Otherwise, it would be 82 south where you would encounter the change from magnetic to true. Let's take a look at the virtual simulator and see this in action. We'll look at the PFD heading display. And again, what we're looking at now is we're climbing out out of 2,200 feet. We're climbing to 10,000 feet. We're retracting flaps on takeoff. And you can see that right now with the selected heading markers at 343, that's in magenta. It's a heading up display. The heading and the track right now are identical. And you can see there is no wind right now. There's no wind vector up here. So as a result, there's no wind. Because there's no wind, the heading and the track will be exactly identical. Again, if we had a direct headwind or a direct tailwind, the heading and the track would be identical. And so that's what we're looking at here. Heading versus track in a no wind situation, they would be lined up because the way we are heading is the same way we are flying. The way we are pointing is the same way as the actual path over the ground is. Now you can see a little bit of wind coming into play here as the wind vector comes into play above 5 knots, and the wind starts to increase, and it is a crosswind from left to right. And now you see there's a little bit of difference here between the heading and the track, because now the way the airplane is pointing is different than the actual path over the ground. As we come up to Nizig here on the ND, which is on the Mountain 7 departure out of Seattle, we're making a right turn to 070 on the SID departure. And you'll start to see now, as we encounter more of the crosswind, there'll be more of a split between the heading and the track. Again, this is a heading up display, and on the ND, it's a track up display. The heading is still displayed as an upside down triangle, but you'll notice at the top is track and not heading. At the top here is heading and not track. But you can see that in both cases, there's a split because of this crosswind. As we continue the turn to 070, once we get on a heading of 070 as per the SID departure, you'll notice that the wind component now becomes a direct tailwind. And as a result, you'll start to see the heading and the track line up again, because there is no difference or very little difference between the heading and the track. Once it becomes pretty much a direct tailwind, which it is now, then you're not going to see either very little difference or no difference between the heading and the track. And that's what we have right now. We have pretty much a direct tailwind, and you'll see that the track line, the white line here, is lined up with the upside down triangle, and here the upside down triangle, which is heading, is lined up with the track line because of this tailwind. We're level at 10,000 feet on the SID departure, and then ATC is going to give us a turn to the right, and we'll make it pretty much a 90 degree turn so we can see the effects of a right to left crosswind. So here maybe ATC tells us to turn right to a heading of 160. So we spin the heading bug to 160, we push heading select. Heading select is shown on the FMA for roll, and the airplane turns to the selected heading. Now you'll notice as we start to pick up that crosswind from right to left, again, there'll be a split between the heading and the track, the way the airplane is actually heading to what your actual flight path is over the ground. And you can see here that the heading in this case will be off to the right, and our actual track will be to the left of that because of that wind that's blowing from right to left. Of course, it will look a little different than what you see on the ND, because on the ND, remember, it's a track up display. So in this case, you can see with that 90 degree crosswind from right to left that the heading is off to our right and track is shown straight ahead of us. So the way the airplane is actually flying is along this track line. That's the actual path over the ground. Of course, the airplane is weather vaned into the wind. It's heading into the wind. And now we'll continue the right turn. ATC perhaps gives us a right turn to 245 or 250 so that we can encounter a direct headwind. And again, just watch the relationship between the PFD and the ND in terms of the heading and the track. As we turn to a heading that will put us into a direct headwind, you'll start to see the heading and the track close the gap, and once again they'll be lined up exactly if it were into a direct headwind. So you see the wind right now has come from 253 at 21 knots, and we're going to a heading at 245. We'll probably update that here to 253 or so, 255, so we get more of a direct headwind. But you'll see even pretty much right now, we're more or less into a direct headwind situation. And the heading and the track are equal. They're the same. The way we're pointing is our actual path over the ground. Now if we take it just one step further from a direct headwind, we're going to go and demonstrate one more thing, and that's to turn to the right 90 degrees. And then we'll show the wind from left to right again. See that again as we turn, the heading and the track will start to differ. As we start to pick up that crosswind component from blowing from the left to the right. And again, you can see that we're going to be, the actual heading is going to be off to the left, but our track is going to be, or the heading in this case is straight up, but we will be weather vaned into the wind, and our actual flight path will be off to our right. On the ND, the track line is at the top, and we would be, our heading would be off to the left here. So in this case, our track is 342, and our heading is 339 or so. Which makes sense for a wind that's coming from left to right. And then finally, we'll take a look at the magnetic versus true. If we put the airplane into true, the heading would be referenced to true north. You'll notice that the reference changes from magnetic to true. There is a white box around the true. The white box stays there in order to tell you that you're in true north. When you go to magnetic, white box around magnetic, but that'll disappear after about 10 seconds. Again, you can either switch to true north by taking, there is a heading reference switch in the airplane that we normally leave in normal. You could take it and put it to true, in which case it would change the heading from magnetic to true. Normally we don't do that, we leave it in magnetic. And if the airplane did transit those points we talked about, 73 north or 60 south within those regions of longitude, or above 82 north or 82 south, the heading would automatically then change from magnetic to true. And the reason being because as you approach the true north pole, the lines of variation get very condensed and the system gets more confused the closer you get between the true north pole and the magnetic north pole. So at the higher latitudes, the reference would change to true automatically. You can see now the white line or the white box here went away. And that's the normal reference. Okay, that completes our discussion on the heading track display on the PFD. So let's lower the HUD and go flying. Till our next briefing, keep the blue side up. Captain Al, out.